Is that all there is? Is that all there is? I'm not satisfied, I cry. Is that all there is? I'd wanted much more. I needed to find a meaning to my life once upon a time. Once upon a cross, Jesus gave his life and died. What was that to me? A man was crucified long ago and far away from the life I live, from my day to day. I could not believe, and yet somehow, some way, I knew that somewhere in this man lay the answers that I sought to help me understand. Once upon my knees, I said a silent prayer, help my unbelief. Jesus, are you there? And from that moment on, in ways I cannot comprehend, my life was turned around, and I had found a friend. So wonderful, and yet a total mystery. Once upon a time, had all come true for me. And every day I'm thankful for the love that I receive. Since I found the faith and the courage to believe, now all my yesterdays have all been left behind. Since Jesus could control once upon a time, he turned my life around. Once upon a time, oh what a friend I found. Once upon a time.
Thank you indeed, Tull, what a blessing. We're glad Daniel O'Donnell didn't want you, because we certainly do. And we just thank God for the ministry that you share along with Jackie, and the blessing that you bring, not just to us as a congregation, but we know you have your CDs that are out there, and we know that there are those who've come to faith because of your ministry. So we just trust the Lord will continue to bless you and use you as you continue to serve him. Our prayers for others will be led this morning by Caroline. She will come and lead us now. Let us pray. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning in what's yet another chapter in this ongoing pandemic. Lord, with our schools come back this week, we lift them to you now. We lift the children who are excited to see their friends again. We lift the Board of Governors, the principals who are making difficult decisions on a daily basis. For teachers who are going back into the classroom to deliver a curriculum under such difficult circumstances. For the cleaners and the caretakers who seek to make the environment safe for our children. And for the parents who are apprehensive about the kids coming back in, we just place this with you now, Lord. Heavenly Father, we continue to think of our government and for the decisions that they're making for us on our behalf on a daily basis to keep us safe. We pray that sick, who's waiting for treatments possibly longer than they should have been due to the current situation. And we pray for their family and friends as they care for them. And we just pray that your healing hand will be upon them. Lord, we continue to think of our church, and we thank you that so many Christian churches have been able to start to meet again. And we know that here in Carrick, we're so thankful for that also. But it's difficult. And we just pray that your Christian message will be proclaimed under these difficult circumstances. Lord, we thank you for our own church here in Carrick. And we'll continue to think of Stephen, our circuit steward, as he takes on more responsibilities with us having our vacancy here in Carrick. We thank you for our local preachers and our retired ministers who are delivering your word to us now. And we pray that you would strengthen them throughout. And we continue to remember Adam and his family. And we pray that when things come together for him, that he will have a smooth passage to us, Lord. And we look forward to him joining us. And Lord, we just think of those in our congregation who haven't felt for one reason or another that they could join us just yet. Whether that's anxiety around the virus or for their own health reasons. And we just ask that you'll be with them as they worship you and come before you in their own way. And that they would know that we're all thinking of them and praying for them too. Lord, we ask these things in your name and we lay them before you in Jesus' name, knowing that you hear and answer all of our prayers.
Writing to the Romans, who were a people who were not only educated, but who were also cultured, I don't think we could call this letter stupid in any way. It's full of truths and instructions for the Christians in Rome. Rebecca read chapter 12 for us. But let's just take a little quick overview of what Paul was saying to the Romans, and also what is God's word wanting to say to each one of us today. Paul wrote this letter to introduce himself and his message to the church in Rome. He had never been to this important city, although he knew the names of many Christians who were there, and he did hope to visit them soon. Paul tells them that he is an apostle, he's been chosen to preach the good news, and the message that he proclaims is God is powerful. He also has a way of saying all people have faith, whether they are Jews or Gentiles. Paul reminds all his readers that all of us have sinned and come short of God's glory. But how can we then be made acceptable to God? This is the main question that Paul answers in this letter. He begins by showing how everyone has failed to do what God requires. The Jews have not obeyed the law of Moses. The Gentiles, they have refused to even think about God, although God has spoken to them in many different ways. Paul is the most famous letter writer in history, and yet letter writing was very rare among the Jews. Jews in the ancient world seldom had cause small country. It was fairly easy for them just to go and visit friends and relatives. Writing and sending letters was an expensive way to communicate, and it was really only used when necessary. In the Roman Empire, there were quite a lot of letters that were written, usually by officials or by wealthy people who could afford to pay the postman to deliver their letter to its destination. So, in the absence of a public postal service, there would have been an important reason for writing a letter, such as a crisis or a major problem. In the ancient world, letters were often very short, generally written on just one sheet of papyrus, and probably no more than 20 words in length. Don't we wish that sermons could be written like that sometimes? Longer letters would require several sheets to be stuck together. Paul's epistles are some of the longest letters that we have in the ancient world. From the ancient world, sorry. His average length was about 1,300 words, and Romans run to 7,114 words, possibly the longest letter written in that period. Now, in all of his letters, Paul follows the same format. His name is always at the start, so that the recipient, by unrolling the first part of the scroll, you could see who sent this letter. Then he added the addresses, so the postman knew where he was taking it. The next thing Paul did was to greet the recipients. This was a pattern typical of most letters written at the time. But Paul used his letters to encourage the church or individuals to whom he was writing. The seven letters to the churches of Asia in the book of Revelation follow exactly the same pattern, with the ascended Jesus commending each church before criticizing it. Next came the subject that was on Paul's mind, which normally made up the bulk of the letter. And at the end, there would be a brief summary covering the main points. And finally, he finishes with more readings and then a signature. I'd like just to read the first few verses of chapter 12 from Eugene Peterson's The Message. And this is what it says. It's titled Place Your Life Before God. So here's what I want you to do. God helping you, take your everyday, ordinary life, your sleeping, eating, going to work, and walking around life, and place it before God as an offering. Embracing what God for you is the best thing you can do for Him. Don't become so well adjusted to your culture that you fit into it without even thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God. You'll be changed from the inside out. So, here we have Paul, keeping it very simple for us. The first thing is, we are not doing this on our own. God is helping us. Ephesians 2 and verse 8 says, "For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God." Our salvation is the gift that God has given us in Christ. He came to be born as a baby, growing into a man, ministering to his people for 3 years, then to climb the hill of Calvary to be nailed to a cross, to suffer and die for your sins and mine, to pay the price of our salvation. God Remember the story of Hannah in the Old Testament. She couldn't have children, yet she faithfully went up to the temple to plead and pray for a son. In her prayer, she tells God, "If I have a son, I will give him back to you for your service." True to her word, once the boy Samuel was of age, Hannah took him to the temple to serve the old priest Eli at Shiloh. We all know this story, how Samuel grew and served God to become one of the greatest prophets in the Old Testament. He was Hannah's living sacrifice. This is what God is asking of us. Not that we need to give our children, but we need to give ourselves. Nothing that is unreasonable. Verse 1 of Romans 12 in the King James Version says, "I beseech you therefore, brethren, that by the mercies of God that you present yourselves as a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service." So first of all, we need to give ourselves to him. Secondly, we need to embrace everything he has done for us. So what is it he has done? He has given us life. He has given us salvation. And he also has given us a family of God. I'm sure you are all aware of Sam Clement's favourite saying, "I am blessed." We all have been blessed by what the Lord has done for us. One of my grandmother's favourite songs was, "Count your blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done." And I have a little quote here from R.C. Sproul from his book, "What is Repentance?" "The difference between the blessed person and the ungodly person is that the blessed person walks according to the course of heaven and not according to the course of this world." Have we embraced everything he has done for us? Or is there that one thing in our lives that we feel God shouldn't have allowed? As much as a Methodist, I love our covenant service every January. When it comes to the covenant prayer, I'm almost hesitant each time to pray it. And this is what the Methodist covenant prayer says: "I am no longer my own but thine. Put me to what thy wilt. Rank me with whom thy wilt. Put me to doing. Put me to suffering. Let me be employed for thee or laid aside for thee. Exalted for thee or brought low for thee. Let me be full, let me be empty. Let me have all things, let me have nothing. I freely and heartily yield all things to thy pleasure and disposal. And now, O glorious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, thou art mine, and I am thine. So be it. And the covenant which I have made on earth, let it be ratified in heaven. Amen." This is embracing everything he has done for us. Allowing him to take our lives and whatever they may be, full or empty, enjoying prosperity or being poor, in good health or sickness, working or unemployed. 2020 has brought many changes to lots of people's lives. There have been those who have been in good health, and yet those who have known sickness. those who have been infected by the coronavirus, and those whose lives have been affected also by the virus, those who remain working, and there have been so many unemployed. There have been so many who have been sad because of loneliness and isolation. Many lives have been changed. Yet for those who have embraced the will of God, have known His peace, no matter what life or the virus has brought their way. They are trusting Him to bring them through this pandemic, no matter how much it affects their lives. They know God is in control. So firstly, we need to give ourselves to Him. Secondly, we need to embrace all He has for us. And thirdly, we need to change. Don't become so well adapted to your own culture that you fit into it, even without thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God and you will be changed from the inside out. I am a new creation, no more in condemnation. Here in the grace of God I stand. Also, another favourite song is Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. Nothing in this world can offer us, can compare to what we have in Christ. Our salvation, we know, is a free gift, but our salvation is the free gift, but our sacrifice is to live a life of holiness, and that is costly. Will we pay the price, or will we still go on living, serving ourselves? I never get tired of telling this little story. It's the story of a wonderful farmer, and all the animals on his farm were treated so well. They all loved the farmer. That is, until one day, the farmer wanted for his breakfast ham and eggs. The pig could not be found. He was in hiding. When the chicken eventually found him, he told him off and demanded to know why he refused to give the farmer what he wanted when the farmer had been so good to them all. The pig cried to the chicken, "It's okay for you. From you, he only needs a contribution. From me, he needs a commitment." It was okay for the chicken to give some eggs, but the pig had to give his life. It's the same from us. It's not a contribution that Jesus requires, because that's easy to give. It's the commitment that He wants. That's costly. He asks us to present our bodies as living sacrifice that is holy and acceptable in His sight. So what is it that is keeping us from Him? It cost Hannah to bring Samuel to the temple in Shiloh and leave him there with Eli, to serve him every day, growing closer to God, until the night he heard God's voice call to him. The sacrifice that she made pleased God. It will also cost us to give ourselves as living sacrifice to God, living daily to serve Him, growing closer until one day we also hear Him as Samuel did, call our name. But only that kind of commitment will please Him. Firstly, we need to give ourselves to Him. Secondly, we need to embrace all He has for us. need to change. No matter what you take from today's service, I would like you to remember four words. God is helping you. He's not asking anyone to face anything or do anything on their own. I'm sure it broke Hannah's heart, giving her son back to God after waiting so long to get him. But God was with Hannah as much as he was with Samuel, and he will be with you every step of the way, no matter what you are facing, if you have accepted his son. Is he calling you to service? Is he calling you to suffer? Is he just calling you to stand up for him and be his witness? No matter what the call, God is helping you. Come today. Lay yourself on his altar of love. Amen. We'll close.